Oh, with you is Senator James Paterson. He's the youngest member of the government, and he's the man behind the new conservative same-sex marriage bill Shalala was just telling us about. Senator, thanks for your time.
Great to be with you.
What's in your bill?
Well, it's similar in some ways to Dean Smith's bill, which you were hearing about earlier, in that it legalises same-sex marriage for the first time in Australia, and it protects the rights of a minister of religion and civil celebrants to decline to solemnise a same-sex marriage. But it goes further in some other respects. It extends that right that other bills grant to religious ministers to anyone else who's directly involved in a wedding, whether they're a religious minister or not.
Why is that important?
The reason for that is that religious freedom is a human right which is universal. That means it's for all of us. It's not something that you have just because you are employed to be a priest or because of your profession. It's an individual human right for everyone. So it's no better to coerce someone who is not a priest into participating in a same-sex marriage than it would be to coerce a priest into doing so.
You don't support a Human Rights Act, and yet you've drafted a bill which focuses specifically on the rights of religious people, preferencing them over the rights of same-sex attracted people, intersex people or trans people. How is that fair?
You're right, I don't support a Bill of Rights, but I don't agree that this is similar in any way to a Bill of Rights, and it certainly doesn't ignore the rights of same-sex couples.
My point is you're focusing here on the rights of religious freedoms, but not on other rights.
Well, no, there are other rights that are protected there, including freedom of speech and freedom of conscience. And your point about people of faith is important. So for your background, for the background of your listeners, I'm agnostic. I'm not a religious person. And I think that people who have a secular belief about marriage have just as much right to be protected as someone who has a religious belief. We shouldn't treat them differently. It's just a subset of freedom of conscience.
If it is about more than religion and includes freedom of speech, would someone be able to refuse service because they just don't agree with same-sex marriage?
Yes, someone would be able to refuse to provide services to a wedding if they have a genuine belief in the traditional version of marriage. That's right.
Even if it's not a religious belief. So they could I just don't want to serve you because you're gay.
Well, they couldn't say it. Let's use some concrete examples. Let's say I'm a baker and I sell cakes. I would not be able to refuse service to a gay person who wants to buy a birthday cake, for example. That is unlawful and would remain unlawful. I would be able to decline to participate in a same-sex wedding. And what that basically means is I couldn't be sued under anti-discrimination law if I chose to use my right of conscientious objection to say, I don't want to participate in this wedding.
Yeah, and what would be the limits of how you say that you're not going to give that service to someone? Could you say that you think that, you know, gay marriage is wrong? Could you say that you think homosexuality is wrong, for example?
The bill protects free speech in that it allows people to explain that they disagree with same-sex marriage, if that's the case, and why they disagree with same-sex marriage, provided that what they say is not harassing or threatening. So there's a limitation on that to make sure that people are not being abused, for example, or harassed.
On the text line, someone says, hopefully if this bill passes, someone can set up a website listing all the companies who refused same-sex marriage services so I can go ahead and never visit that baker. Bakers will sell a baguette to a gay person but not a gay couple. What the hell? And Elise in Canberra, you say, so should a taxi driver be able to refuse rides to divorced people? James?
A taxi driver wouldn't be able to refuse rides to a gay couple, so they certainly shouldn't be able to refuse it to a divorced couple either.
Wouldn't they be able to refuse it to a gay couple going to their wedding?
No. So the bill has a provision which covers transport to and from wedding, but what that's intended to protect is, for example, a wedding hire car business.
So you can get a cab but not a hire car?
I'll explain to you if you like. So often in the wedding industry business, people who offer their cars for weddings, they're often small businesses or sole traders. They own their own car, they drive their own car. They're intimately connected and involved in the wedding because they drive the couple, you know, to and from the church or wherever they choose to get married and to and from the reception. A taxi driver is just transporting people from one place to another. They're not involved in the wedding in any sense of the word. So that's why
it feels like you're splitting hairs, though. I mean,
an important distinction. Because a taxi driver is just providing transport services to anyone to go anywhere. It doesn't matter where they're going. He has no or she has no involvement in that. But obviously a wedding car driver is involved directly in the marriage.
Let's get to some other examples. Could someone refuse service at a food shop?
No.
If they were buying food for the wedding?
Well, they couldn't be required to supply food to a wedding.
So they could refuse service.
Well, when you asked that, I thought you meant if I walked into a food store and I was a gay person, could I be refused service because I'm gay? No, you couldn't. But if you tried to engage that business to supply the food for your wedding and they disagreed with same-sex marriage, they would not be. You would not be able to force them to do so.
So you just need to, if you're a lesbian wanting a wedding dress, you just have to go into the wedding shop and say it's not for a wedding. You just want that dress to get around it, right?
You could do that if that was your choice. You could do that, yes.
You're listening to Senator James Paterson. He's announced a new same-sex marriage bill, which would allow all kinds of people to refuse service to gay people for their weddings. And it also has a clause which means parents can pull their kids out of classes they don't agree with. Senator, your colleague Trent Zimmerman says the issues you're discussing here are separate to the issue of same-sex marriage. What do classroom lessons have to do with same-sex marriage?
Well, I think this is an important part of the bill because just as parents are allowed to remove their children from religious instruction in schools, parents who have religious views should be able to ask for their children not to participate in teaching of things that are inconsistent with their religious values. It actually enacts provisions of the Charter of the Rights of the Child, which is a UN charter, which says that parents have a right to control the moral and religious education of their children.
Is this just for Christian faith, or is that also true for, say, Islam?
It's true for anyone.
Would you say it's fair enough if someone refused service on the basis of race or age?
No, I don't propose to change that.
Then why is sexuality fair game?
Well, we're having a postal marriage survey at the moment and we'll get the exact result on Wednesday, but I suspect that roughly 30 to 40% of Australians will vote no. That's a very significant proportion of our fellow Australians, and I believe that although they shouldn't be able to deny gay couples the right to get married, they also shouldn't be compelled to participate in a marriage that they don't believe in.
Do you expect that this bill will pass?
Look, I don't know. I've put it forward for the feedback and consideration of my colleagues, and I hope that it will stimulate debate, as it seems to have, and I hope that they'll consider it carefully and positively, but ultimately it's in their hands what they each choose to support or not support.
You probably won't get opposition support for this one with the winding back of anti-discrimination laws introduced by the Shadow Attorney General.
Just on that, I think it's worth remembering that the Labor Party is also having a free vote on this issue, and that some Labor MPs during the campaign have spoken about their concerns about some of the flow-on consequences of same-sex marriage, particularly for people of religious faith. So I'm not presuming anything about them, but I think it wouldn't be safe to assume that they will vote as a bloc.
Do you think that this is going to really delay the process of getting same-sex marriage in Australia?
I don't want it to delay it at all. I voted yes. I've been on the record supporting same-sex marriage for a long time, far back as June 2011, when I was 23 years old.
The amendments probably mean that it will be delayed, though.
Well, my view is it has to be done by Christmas. The Parliament cannot leave before Christmas if there's been a yes vote, not having legalised same-sex marriage. So I'll be working very hard towards that. My bill, though, could be passed through the Parliament as quickly as any other bill could. And in fact, because it's got embedded in it already those protections that a lot of people have been calling for, it may require less amendment than another bill that doesn't have those protections already in there.
Well, we'll see whether other senators agree with you. Senator, thanks for your time.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
That was Senator James Paterson from the government. You're listening to Hack on Triple J.